In this lecture, we are going to see some basic components of java.awt package. To be specific, we are going to look at label, button, checkbox and checkbox group. Let's first look at the label component. This is available as a class in java.awt package and it will help you to display a string in a GUI. So here you see enter name, enter password. These are strings that are displayed and give some information about the other components that are put up here. So such strings you can display by using label component. We'll see some of the constructors here. You see a default constructor. There is a constructor which takes a string as a parameter. So this string that I'm passing here will be displayed as a label. The third constructor is where I pass a string as a parameter and along with that I also give the alignment. By default, the label that you put in here will have its text aligned on the left hand side. If you want to change it, then in that case, you can use this constructor. This alignment option can be any one of these that are specified here, left, right, or center. Now, these are static constants defined in label class. So, they should be used as label.left and so on. Then we have methods. So first method is setText method, which takes string as a parameter and this string again will be displayed here as a label. This method we use in two cases. In the first case, when we are using a default constructor to create a label. In such a case, we do not pass the string as a parameter. So which string should be displayed in the label is decided by setText method. The second case where we use the setText method is when during the program execution, I want to change the string that is displayed in the label. Anytime I wish to know what is the text displayed in the label, I can use getText method. I can also change the alignment of the text that is displayed in the label by using setAlignment. It takes alignment as a parameter and again this alignment can be any one of these options that are specified. GetAlignment method will help you to fetch the current alignment for the label. Let's look at a method here. At the top you see two imports, java.awt and java.applet. So this is for including the label class and this is for using the applet class. Then we have an applet tag. We have a class label demo which is extending applet. And inside this you will see an init method. Now init method is a method defined in applet class which we are overriding here. This method is used for initializing the applet. That is for doing things before the applet is actually displayed. So, all the components that you have to create, you're going to create in init method. And the second thing that you're going to do is, once these components are created, they have to be added to the applet. So, two things you will do in init method. First, create all the components. Second, add them to the applet. So, let's see how that is done in init method. So, here we create a component called as one, which is an object of label class, instantiate, call the constructor, pass the string as a parameter that should be displayed in the label and set the alignment. So, alignment here is set as right. Then after that, there is a new method that you see here which is set background and this set background is called on the component 1. So, it will change the background color of label 1 and it will change that color to color.red. The effect of these two statements you see here. So, there is red background, there is one displayed and one is right aligned. Next, we create another component called as 2, which is created using a default constructor. The background color of 2 is set as color.blue and the text is displayed as 2. So, these three statements are having the effect of displaying 2, which is left aligned, which is default alignment. The background color is blue and the text displayed is 2. So, here you will see that because 2 is created using a default constructor, we use setText method for putting 2 as a text in the label. Next, we have another label created called as 3. And there is Nothing new here. We say new to instantiate. We call the constructor and set the text. So here you see the effect of creating such a label. Then there is another label created called as for, and this is created using a default constructor. So I must set the text that should get displayed in for, and in for I want to display the same text that was displayed in 3. So what I would do is, first I will fetch the text that is displayed in 3 by saying 3.getText. So that fetches me 3, and this 3 is passed as parameter to setText method of 4. So for 4, the text will be displayed as whatever is the text in label which is having name 3. So this is how I have created all the components. Now once all the components are created, the second step I told you to add them to the label. So we call add method one after the other and pass the components that I wish to add as parameter. Remember that the sequence in which you add the components is important. So if you add one first, one will appear first here. If you add two second time, the second component that you're adding is two, so two appears after one, and so on. Next, in the previous program you saw a method called as setBackground. So that was used for changing the background color of a particular component. There is also a method called as setBackground that will help me to set the text color of a particular component. So let's say if in a label I want to change the color with which the string is displayed. Okay, so then in that case I will use setForeground method. So for example here, I want that this 3 should be displayed with red color. So 3 will be displayed with red color by calling a method setForeground and passing color.red as a parameter. Both these methods are defined in the component class. There are also methods getBackground and getForeground for fetching the background color and the foreground color that the component is using. Let's move on to the next component, that is button. It is a push button. It contains a label, and when you click on it, there is some action that you can take. So that action we call as the event. Next, we have a constructor, default constructor. We have a constructor that takes string as a parameter, and this string that you pass here will be displayed as a label here. You can also use a default constructor to create a button and then call setLabel for changing or for setting the string that should be displayed here. Anytime you wish to know that in a button what label is displayed, you can call getLabel. So here you see a program. We have two imports. As usual, we have applet code, applet tag. We have a class which is extending applet. Within this class, first step is to create the components. So we create RBTN, GBTN, BBTN. These are three objects of button class that are declared here. Then write init method for initializing each of them. So we call new to instantiate, call the constructor, pass the string as a parameter. You see the effect of them here, red, green and blue. So this is the second step. Third step is to call add in the required sequence to add each of the buttons in the applet. So when you execute this program, this is the effect that you're going to see. You can click on each of these buttons. Right now the program does not take any action when you click on the button. So next few lectures we will learn how to associate some actions with these buttons. Let's move on to the next component, that is checkbox. Checkbox will help you to develop a program or develop a GUI where you can put certain options. These options you can toggle on or off. So you can select the option, you can deselect the option. Also, checkboxes will help you to put multiple options, multiple option selection. So out of, let's say if you have put 5 options as checkboxes, out of these 5, you have a choice of doing as much selection as you want. So here you see 2 checkboxes put up. I can choose one, any one of them. I can also choose both of them, or I may not choose any of them. Here there are constructors. So we have a default constructor, we have a constructor where we pass string as a parameter and the string will be displayed here as a label. The third constructor is again where we pass a string as a parameter, and we can also specify whether this checkbox should be appearing as selected or deselected. So this one is appearing as selected and this one is appearing as deselected. Then there are methods getState and setState, which will help you to know and set the selected state of the checkbox. So if I want this checkbox to be selected, I can call setState and I can pass the value as true. Anytime I want to know what is the label or the string displayed here, I can call getLabel. Anytime I wish to set the label, I can call setLabel method and pass the required string as a parameter. So here you see the output where there are four checkboxes displayed and one of them is checked. So let's see how to create such an output. We have imports, we have applet tag, we have a class which extends applet. Again, first step, declare the objects of the required class. So there are four checkbox objects created because that is how I want the output to be. Then write init method, create each of them. So call new for instantiating, call the constructor. Look at the first constructor call. Here I write Windows XP and the second parameter passed is true. So that is how, this is the on state. So that is how this Windows XP is appearing as selected. The next three checkboxes are created in a similar fashion where we just pass the string. By default, they all will be appearing as deselected. So this is the second step. So first step was creation, second step was instantiating and calling the constructors, and the third step is to add them to the applet one after the other. Next, we have a class called as CheckboxGroup. This class will help me to create a set of mutually exclusive checkboxes. Mutually exclusive checkboxes are those where out of multiple checkboxes, I can only select one. So such checkboxes are usually called as radio buttons. There is only one default constructor in this class and there are two methods. One is getSelectedCheckbox, which will tell me which checkbox was selected, and another is setSelectedCheckbox, which will help me to set the checkbox which should appear as selected. Along checkbox group is not the only class that we are going to use. So along with checkbox group, we use a class called as checkbox for creating the radio buttons. So these are the two constructors that we of checkbox class that will be useful to us. We have already seen the first and the second parameter. The third parameter is the checkbox group to which a particular checkbox belongs. You can also change the sequence in which the checkbox group is given. So just compare these two constructors that you see here and see the difference. Let's look at an example and understand how this group is created. So I'll just go to the next slide and show you the output. So here the same four checkboxes are created, but this time they are created as radio buttons. So only one of them I'll be able to select. Now how do we do that? So I'm directly going to come inside this class. There are four checkbox that are created, checkbox objects that are declared here, and there is one checkbox group that is selected here. Come to init method, and the first thing you would do is inside init method is create the checkbox group. So I create CBG equal to new. There is only one default constructor that you can use for creating this checkbox group. So create that and see how all the four checkboxes are created. So we write new, we call the constructor, we write the string, and the second parameter for all of them is CBG. Okay, so what this means is that all these four checkboxes that I am creating, they belong to one checkbox group, that is CBG. So once I make all the checkboxes belong to one checkbox group, they start behaving like a radio button. Third is the parameter on and off. So here I have true, that is how the first checkbox or first radio button will appear as selected, and rest all are having parameter false, and that is how all of them will appear as deselected. So after that, we have our final step where we add all of them one after the other to the applet. So you see the effect here. So now if I select this, this appears as selected because that is what we have set in the program. and the rest of them are appearing deselected. So if I select, let's say, Mac OS, this will automatically be deselected.